This roadshow is brought to you by researchbytes.com.
Good evening. Welcome to our 10th investor conference. I'm counting from our listing date of 2006 March. I'm very, very happy to be amongst you. I'll introduce people on the dais. Mr. Ramesh Iyer, Managing Director and President of the Financial Services Sector. Anuj Mehra, Managing Director, Mahindra Housing Finance. Jaydeep Devare, Managing Director, Mahindra Insurance Brokers, two of the subsidiaries. Dinesh, who heads our Treasury and Investor Relations. Rakesh, who is a Manager Treasury. You would have seen the numbers by this time. I am seeing the happy faces here. We are also equally happy. Except, of course, when we talk of happy numbers, there is always a concern behind what's way forward. That's where we have Ramesh here probably to guide us and give you some kind of a way forward inputs. The agenda for the evening will be like this. Dinesh will talk about the performance of the company, standalone performance of the company, followed by Anuj, who will talk about Mahindra Housing. It is sort of an uprising star within our segment. Then Jaydeep will talk about the distribution business, insurance distribution business, where we are making a mark for ourselves and how we are becoming one of the biggest insurance brokers in India. And then Mr. Ramesh will give an overview of what's happened in the year which has just passed by, as well as what you can look forward to. And thereafter, we will throw open the forum for questions and answers. Good evening, and once again, welcome.
Thank you, Ravi. We have already shared the presentation with all the analysts and the email IDs where we have received for the request of this presentation. As far as we have uploaded our presentation, this analyst presentation, on our website. Any further queries post that, we will be happy to take it from you during Q&A, as well as subsequently, if you have any further queries, you can write back to us. I will briefly touch upon some of the highlights and numbers. On a standalone basis, our income grew by 12%, or PAT up by 7% annually for a Q4. Our AUM for the year crossed 8% for 36,000 crore plus. Our board has recommended 200% dividend. Our customer base has crossed 3.6 million. I'm just going to go through the presentation. We continue to focus in the rural and semi-urban market. Our area of focus continues to be around financing the vehicles and SME space. In this financial year, we have added 215 branches, and we have increased our rural presence to 1,108 locations across the country. In this financial year, we have received a AAA rating from three rating agencies, namely CARE rating, India rating, and Brickwork rating. We continue to have a AA+ rating from the CRISIL. These are our subsidiary companies. And during the year, one of our 100% subsidiary companies has been merged, and for which we have added a footnote. So it was purely a workforce company which was supplying a workforce to the company, MBPCL. So this is the journey so far, and as I was highlighting, current year we have received a AAA from the three rating agency, and we have crossed a 3.6 million customer base. This is our top 10 shareholding list for the year, as of 31st March 15. Some overview about the automobile financing industry, which is based on projected information given by the CRISIL Research House. And what we see is that going forward, the geographies where we represent, we believe that there is a huge opportunity and the scope for us to continue to believe that the market potential which is offered in this space where we are focused on continues to be in the band of 10%+ growth rate. In fact, the CAGR growth rate projected by the CRISIL House is ranging between 15% to 18%. And this is the similar growth information which is shared on account of the automobile industry space. So even the automobile industry space projected by the Crisil House has been more than 12% for most of the years. Our growth drivers continues to remain for the addressable market in the segments where we operate, that is the small cars, the UV and the van space, at a 12 to 14% band in the current projected years. And we are expecting to leverage our reach and the space where we operate through a good relationship or a healthy relationship which we have built over a period of time through the network and the dealership. These are the volume actual number of the auto industry for the last financial year. And against that, how we have fared is going to follow in our numbers. Some brief again about the housing finance industry, because we have a subsidiary company in the form of Mahindra Rural Housing Finance. Of course, our subsidiary company's MD, Mr. Anuj Mehra, is going to briefly touch upon the scope and the opportunity. But this is a snapshot of, again, the coverage or the area, how we look, where we believe that tier 3 and tier 2 market are going to expand, continue to grow in the band of 20%+ in the geographies, and how we are going to leverage that going forward. Our business strategy continues to remain focused on the rural and semi-urban market, expand the branch network, continue to be deeply pocketed into rural geographies where we are present, use our existing customer as a franchisee or a spokesperson to further enhance the relationship and get the new businesses in that market, diversify within the asset class or the product mix where we are present, broad-base as much as possible the liability side as well for the risk management point of view, diversify from all the sources now since we have received a AAA rating. We are trying to improve relationship and increase our penetration in the markets where we were not present earlier. So we have seen the good level of interest from the FIs and the PF market for our liability franchise. Continue to attract and retain talent from the local market. We have a healthy relationship with some of the local colleges and universities wherein we regularly go and recruit fresh people or graduates and train them on our work. Our endeavor is going to remain on how to improve productivity and efficiency in the system, and for that we try and every year focus or continuous focus will remain on the technology. I'm sure Mr. Iyer is going to touch upon this area. And of course, not but least, Mahindra ecosystem where we are going to leverage for SME space as well as the many more areas. This is a branch network. As I said, we had added 215 branches during the year, and it is well distributed across the pockets of the country. Our product mix continues to remain the same as we have been focusing upon the vehicle financing and the pre-owned vehicle and SME financing. Breakup of AUM, more or less almost same, barring for some of the asset class, which is the reflection of the industry volume. If you see the tractor industry volume, there was a degrowth of close to 13%, which is reflecting in our AUM growth also. Similarly, on the car portfolio, the growth rate has been virtually flat, or our AUM has been virtually flat, primarily because the rural economy or the rural market, what we have seen the car growth is largely driven from the urban pockets. And we have yet to see the similar type of growth pattern coming back in the rural economy. To give you the breakup of the pre-owned vehicles and the others, it's around 13% is from the used vehicle portfolio on the asset finance, and balance 5% is from the SME and the dealer financing portfolio. Again, the same on the asset book side, entire book breakup given on the, again, to give a breakup of the pre-owned vehicle on the AEM basis and the others, roughly around 9.5% is from the used vehicle portfolio, and others is SME and the retail trade advance given to the dealers. So as I was expressing, the rating agencies have upgraded our rating. Couple of rating agencies have upgraded our rating, and CARE has given us the fresh AAA rating. On a liability mix, we continue to have a healthy mix of our liability from all the sources possible. The existing bank liability which is there continues to be there. As and when the liability is maturing, we will try and see how we can balance the mix by raising more and more funds from the fund market or the money market. As I was expressing, more FIs and the PF market are opening up because of our improved rating, as well as we are seeing the bond market improvement overall. This is the employee management, some of the initiatives the company has been regularly taking. We have our own academy and development center for regular training programs and conducting and retaining talent. As far as technology initiatives, we are connected almost all the branches, all our field officers, all our executives on the field are regularly connected through a GPS, through the handheld instrument which they are carrying on the field. Key financial for the year, for the quarter, our income grew by 12%, PAT grew by 7%, increased in the value of asset finance for the quarter. And similarly, for the financial year basis, our total income grew by 13%, PAT degrew by 6%, value of asset finance degrew by 4%. Again, growth trajectory on a CAGR basis, we have plotted numbers. This is available in presentation which we are going to upload on. It should be available on our website. Similarly, on the cost to income ratio, return on asset basis and asset quality basis. See, our return on net worth basis, since now we have almost 5%, both subsidiary companies have started contributing 5% of our bottom line. Our return on equity ratio, one has to include even the subsidiary company on a console basis. So effectively, I would say our return on equity will increase by almost 100 basis point from here, if you include both these two subsidiary companies' contribution. There is a standalone performance of the company. If you see on a quarter-on-quarter basis as well as YOY basis, this is the information. I don't want to read out the numbers probably. We have tried to improve the presentation format over the previous quarters. In the format, some of the analysts and some of the investors had suggested some changes in that. So we have tried to incorporate that into this presentation. One thing which I would like to highlight here, as I was expressing, there is a merger of MBPCL, our subsidiary company. To that extent, there is a movement of expenses from other expenses to employee benefit expenses. Similarly, if you read the notes on our press release and the presentation, there is a roughly around 20 crore write-back on account of employee incentive which we had announced last year for the performance pay, and which did not materialize because the performance criteria. So we had reversed that, but that is a normal practice. Every year we do this practice. Current year also we would have provided based on the performance of the expectations. And if that materializes, the incentives are given accordingly, there is a role write backs. Here's a standard balance sheet. So if you see the drop in the current investment is primarily the investment on account of some of the arbitrage investment we do take if there is an opportunity in the money market available in the form of the public sector bank CDs or something like that. To that extent, there can be a movement. So some of the numbers of the key subsidiary companies. Rural Housing Finance, I'm sure Anuj Mehra is going to speak much more about the business plans and the growth opportunity. For the sake of a number, The company has in the quarter grew almost 45% and registering a growth of almost 50%, 54% plus on a income side for the year. On a bottom line side, registering growth of close to 73% over the previous year. Similarly, on the MIBL side, this another subsidiary company, which is a fee-based income contribution, as well as expressing 5% of our bottom line is now contributed by both the subsidiary companies. So they continue to grow in line with the company's volume growth, and so they continue to contribute above 5%, close to 5% of our bottom line. Consolidated numbers. Some of the ratios, key ratios, we have a healthy capital adequacy ratio of 18.3%, even tier 1 is 15% plus, and we have declared a 200% dividend for the year. Our asset under management has now 36,000 plus crores. So again, if you see the last couple of rows, there is a movement of employees from our subsidiary company into the parent company because of the merger. The spreadsheet for the spread analysis on the spread basis, how the total income for the year stack up, the overhead and write-off and the net spread. The gross NPA numbers. In fact, if I were to see from the December number, it was around close to 2,500 crore gross NPA number, which has come down to 2,099 2,100 numbers. The gross NPA, in fact, was at December 7.2%, which has come down to 5.9%. And our coverage ratio, which was around 54%, has gone up to 61%. Some of the awards which we have received during the last financial year, and we continue to believe that we will continue to work towards the how to maintain this type of areas where we can showcase our leadership and areas of improvement. Risk management practices which we have been following for the NPL and the other areas where we believe that there are risks and how do we mitigate those risks. So we have accelerated provisioning norm over the RBI norm. Of course, there are new suggested pipeline based on which we have to follow in the coming years. So we have to migrate to 90-day DPD in the coming year, and based on that, to that extent, there will be a NPL provision which will go up, or the NPL numbers will go up. With this, I conclude my presentation, and I request Anuj first to give a brief about the company.
This year, in terms of disbursements of about 55%, we had a PBT growth of almost 83% at 67 crores. We've had a PAT growth of 62% at 44 crores. So all in all, it's been a fairly satisfying year. Partly as a consequence of this kind of performance, which the rating agencies saw for themselves during the course of the year, we have been rated AA plus by two of the rating agencies. Going forward, we believe we are going to continue focusing on the core business of rural housing finance. We will continue to do more and more coverage within the villages that we are covering and extend our reach, both in the states we are already present as well as in certain new states. However, we are also going to be adding a slightly different strategic thrust this year, in addition to the rural thrust, which is the emphasis on affordable housing and semi-urban housing. We believe we have understood how to estimate income when it comes to customers who don't have any documentation to prove their income. We have developed our skills estimating those kind of incomes. Using those skills, we are now going to try and expand to the semi-urban part of the country, which is really the class four towns, etc., where we feel there is a huge potential because none of the established players really are making a dent in that market, and it's a very large market. In addition, as all of you are aware, one of our group companies, Lifespaces, is very keen and is focusing on the affordable housing segment. So there is a possibility of some amount of synergy between us and that company, which we would like to leverage. So that's one strategic thrust, which is different in the coming, which will be different in the coming years as compared to what we have been doing. We do hope that that's going to provide us with another growth engine, and we hope we will continue to grow, if not faster, in at least the kind of rates of growth that we have been growing. Thank you very much.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I represent the insurance broking business. We started in the year 2004, and we just completed 10 years in May 2014. This has been a very interesting and a very encouraging journey for us because our capital, which was invested by Mahindra Finance when we started, was just about 50 lakhs. And today we are talking about a net worth of this company, which is upward of about 170 crores. So it's a span of 10 years we've been able to build this business. Our business essentially consists of direct broking and and reinsurance broking. The direct broking business essentially focuses on providing insurance services to the rural segment. So we use the whole Mahindra Finance infrastructure and the customer base, and we have tailor-made solutions to offer to those customers. And our tagline, if I have to use it very simplistically, is to offer Arogya Dhan Sampada, which means health, wealth, and life solutions to our customers. So that is what we do. We are very happy to state that in the last 10 years, we have now generated enough traction in the market, and in the financial year closed just now, last year that is, we touched a premium of 1,000 crores, okay? So which means we are now arrived at a different league of insurance broking business. There are a handful of brokers out of 330 odd brokers who operate in the country who can talk about these kind of numbers. But more than the numbers, what we feel is that we've been able to bring insurance to the markets which were otherwise underserved and underpenetrated. So that has been our biggest satisfaction. Our solutions now reach to almost 1,40,000 villages. Okay, so that's where we find satisfaction, if I have to say that. Because businesses will generate, you know, we are, end of the day, we are a commercial enterprise, so we will generate profits. But our biggest satisfaction we get is when we start reaching those solutions to those underserved customers. So that's a part of our direct broking business. For the numbers, for last year, we touched about 1.14 million customers. So, and on an overall basis, since the time we started the company, we have been able to service over 5 million customers. And the population of this country is very large. Obviously, there is enough underpenetrated markets which we can go and, you know, piggy ride. As and when Mahindra Finance goes into deeper segments of the customers, we are able to go and reach those segments. So our job is to make sure that we are able to service those customers because that's a base available to us to provide those solutions. We also have the reinsurance broking business, which is offering insurance solutions to insurance companies. And that's a relatively new business for us. It's just about 2.5-3 years old. But that's one business area which will also grow as the economy picks up. When more insurance starts happening in this country, the insurance companies will also start placing their businesses outside India, which is called the reinsurance broking, reinsurance business. And we play a part of giving them this advice on how to place business and which companies to place business with. And Lloyd's markets in London is one of the biggest markets there. As a matter of statistic, we've been able to reach the benefits of insurance, reinsurance broking also to about 30 countries. So we transact on a global basis now for that part of our business. Just want to go back to the direct broking part. We also service the corporates and SME segment, and we have created a lot of solutions for corporates and SME segment because that's another area which is going to come up. So when the whole country is talking about Make in India, SME is going to be the biggest structure there, which is going to help India to grow. And we have started providing solutions to that SME segment. So these are the two or three key drivers which will help us to grow in the next phase of our journey, which is looking at the next 10 years. Our vision for 2020, we have gone ahead and announced it, is to be India's first company to be among the global top 100 insurance brokers in revenue. Okay, so we are going to compete in the global market now, for especially because we have the reinsurance broking business. But the largest part of the business will still come from India, because India's story is going to be the biggest story in the next decade. As they say, this decade is for India. And our role is to make sure that we are able to reach maximum number of customers to provide them insurance solutions. So that's a snippet of what we do, and I'll be happy to take questions at a later point. Thank you.
Good evening. So I think my first comment would be, both Anuj and Jaydeep should get more airtime from the next meeting, which means they should grow so big that we should be the third to present. So this is the precedent that they have set. I should think so. So let me use the opportunity to set some targets for them as well. But interestingly, you know, this business is a very simple business, and I have been interacting with, I guess, almost everyone in this room at some point or the other. So I was thinking to myself, what really drives this business? What gets it to a different direction? So there's some 5-6 themes I would like to share with you. One is, don't chase growth, but don't stop chasing recovery. So you have to chase, but don't chase growth. Ensure that you chase recovery at all point of time. I think the second simple fundamental, don't take relationships for granted. Be it OEMs, be it dealers, be it customers, be it employees, whosoever. I don't think we should take relationships for granted. I think third is, please do not innovate in this business unnecessarily and get complicated. Keep it as simple as you can. Keep it so simple that you must all the time almost fear that somebody else can also copy. But don't worry. I think the next is, however you may invest in technology and do whatever you want, don't stop penetrating and going closer to customer. You shouldn't do that at all, because last mile connectivity is the success story of this business. I think the next is, don't stop learning. You should almost every day know little more than what you knew yesterday. If the day you do not know something more than yesterday, I think there is something to worry about. For sure there is something to worry about. I think these are the very, very basic fundamentals of this business, and I think if we do this right, I think we will always have less to explain and more to celebrate. I mean, last, I would think, more than 4 quarters. After all, what's our role? We are only an enabler. I don't think we generate business. We are enablers. At the end of the day, vehicles and tractors and factories and everything will have to produce and sell, and we will help them sell. And therefore, I don't think I will have an answer if somebody was to say, why aren't you growing? I mean, that's already known to everybody. If somebody is degrowing at 35%, where am I going to grow? In fact, if I grow against all those odds, you must rather ask a question, what are the wrong things you are doing? So I don't think we are going to ever come and tell you that, oh, even if everyone else degrows, I'm going to do something very different. Right? But in order to still grow, what are we doing? And that's where comes the element of relationship. Now, we have something like 3.5-4 million customers that we have worked with, and we keep saying about it almost all the time. I think these are times to really test that relationship, that is the customer still willing to use you for his financial needs? Is he willing to refer to you more customer from the villages where he lives in? And therefore, even though you are not generating the sale, do you come to know of it before anybody else comes to know? And that is one growth direction. Today, if a dealer sells 100 vehicle, I get 30 vehicle to finance. How can I know before the dealer sells that he is going to sell 100 vehicle, and instead of 30, therefore, can I get 40? So it will be a market share increase that's possible. But you can't expand the market to say, oh, because of me, you will grow from 100 to 120. Some marginal expansions will happen. Because at the end of the day, it's also important to believe that a financial intermediary, if he cannot take the OEMs or a dealer to a new market, then you are going to compete where there is almost everyone out there. Either you will sacrifice on quality or you will sacrifice on margin. Then what's a great idea of this penetration? So the penetration must be your strategic differentiator, which will tell the dealer, if you work with me, I give you so many more villages. If you work with me, I give you so many more customers whom I already know. And therefore, am I not different from others? I think that's what will ensure that you remain in that growth trajectory. And as I said, don't chase growth. So therefore, these are difficult times. I don't think we want to come under any pressure and say, oh, let's increase the LTV to 95% and temporarily grow through that. And then when the market starts improving, we can be better off. Or say different things like, so what if the dealer is offering 10%, 15% discount? Let's pre-discount price, let's finance. After all, after 6 months, the discount will vanish and then the market will take care of itself. I don't think we want to have that approach. So if you look at what have we done, we've said don't increase the LTV, so what if the volumes are low? Nothing wrong. I mean, I'm not able to really ever appreciate too much if somebody says, why aren't you growing 20%? I still do 500,000 car. I still lend 25,000 crore. If it can produce the same size of profit that a 20% business growth produced, so what if I don't grow 20% if I still make all that money? So I think there are times where you will have to work on your efficiencies and make your money rather than just look at absolute volume to be the only way to grow businesses. And these are the testing times. We have gone through them in the last 3 or 4 quarters. I mean, we were asked several questions in the 3rd quarter, and we believe to have explained, but I'm reasonably sure not everybody accepted our explanation, right? And one of the questions was, two questions, just about after the post-election, one question was, every 5 years this election comes, why it only affects you this year? That was one question that was asked. And then in the 3rd quarter, the question that was asked was, everybody else is not suffering so much as you are suffering. Believe in me, that's a question made us feel we are unique. While that question was addressed to us from a pressurizing position or from a negative approach to say that you seem to be suffering more than everybody else, but believe in me, that was a strategic eye-opener for us to further believe that we are unique and different from others. And then you look back in history, you will find almost every time we have grown when nobody else has grown, and therefore we suffered when nobody else was suffering. And maybe therefore the truth is, we will be better than everybody else. When others will struggle, maybe we will be growing. Now it's not a commitment, it's an expectation, right? But I still believe very strongly that I don't think we have problems on the asset side. I don't think, let's imagine that every sales pickup, tractor sales once again, does not go back to growth, but it just flattens out once again from a degrowth story. Just imagine automobiles becomes flat and not grow. No issues. Look at all the car manufacturers who have set up dealerships already. I mean, you go now into semi-urban rural market and you will see Ford and Toyota showrooms, which were not there 5 years back, 4 years back. But unfortunately, not enough volumes get transacted because the market is a little dull. But will it be like this forever? I mean, I can tell you and I may foolishly invest sometime somewhere, but at the rural or a semi-urban level, a dealer will never put in 2-3 crores unless he is able to see some future. He will never put. And if he has put in already 2-3 crores of rupees, he has his pulse in hand and he knows this is likely to happen. And that is our strategic preparedness. When we open 200 branches, 250 branches in less than 12 months' time, good news for us is you open a branch, it can be busy with recovery. And recovery is the best way to learn this business. And then when the market returns back to growth, these branches can deliver business. That's the power of this business, that you're locally there to be able to capitalize on all that is happening. So if you look at in this quarter, and when the question was posed to us, why are you suffering when nobody else is? And the explanations we gave you was, there are some delays in cash flow. We knew it at local level that the crop is out, but the money is not. And that's what we explained last time. And some of those corrections has what flown into this quarter. So if you ask me, oh, has everything now changed in rural? Is fundamental substantially changed? Is this the new normal from today? I want to tell you the answer is no. It is not a new normal. It is some corrections of the past and some outcome of the efforts. And I don't want to tell you that next 12 months you will see every quarter this is going to be the true story. But the true story is that we have covered 61% of our NPA already. We have left with 40% to cover. We have only 2 jobs in hand. Make sure that no new contract moves into NPA. Create a wall by which you at least collect one installment every month to make sure that he doesn't progress into next. And then the available customer, the 40%, you are on a better wicket now to decide whether you want to repossess these vehicles or work with the customer and collect your money. Because these are the ones where the collateral will protect your principal. There was a question posed to us, why aren't you repossessing vehicles? And if you recall my answer, I said it's a very, very scientific decision on the basis that what will you get if you sell the vehicle, if you're going to get loss? What's the point? You're not going to vacate the market. Why do you take temporary actions? So one another fundamental of this business is, please act, do not react. This has been learned by us the hard way. Invariably, I see when something goes wrong, you react to that and say, take some shortcut decisions. But these are businesses where you need to know to act and not react. And we did exactly this. We did not vacate a single market out from there. We did not foolishly repossess vehicle and cut loss from the market. We would not be used by anybody if that's what we were to do. We consciously stay put in that market and we've got benefit of being continuing in that market. So I think we very strongly think that when growth returns, we are fully ready to capitalize on that. Even in this year, we have added something like 1,000 people. So we are 17,000-18,000 people in the system. We have added 200-300 branches. We have ensured that relationship with every manufacturer is in place. I think no sooner the growth returns, you will not have time to prepare yourself. So we have built all the required resources to be able to capitalize when the growth returns. But fundamentally, even in this year, until we start, the first signal of growth returning will be known when the discounts in the market stop. The day you go to dealership and he says, don't negotiate any discount, you should know the growth has returned. I think the second signal you will get when the growth returns is there is a demand for second-hand vehicle going up and people are willing to pay a price. You must know the growth has returned. The third reasons or the third indicator of growth returning would be when the customer is not negotiating for higher quantum of finance. If today when the customer says, give me 90% loan or a 95% loan, you must know that he is not willing to invest because he is not able to see volumes. The day he says, here is my 25%, please give me a loan urgently, you must know the growth has returned. And the fourth is when customer calls up and says, I will not pay penal interest if you don't collect my installment, you must know the growth has returned. I think if these indicators are visible, we will ensure that we get benefit of that growth. And that's what we are preparing ourselves for. But then what differentiates us from everybody else? Is our penetration, our long experience in that market, our substantially very high level of relationship at every level there, and therefore when he gets money, we are the first to get it. And that's what was demonstrated in this quarter, that when we chase for money day after day, month after month, when he gets money in his hand first, we get the benefit of that money. And which is why I'm saying the last mile connectivity for this business is absolutely essential. If somebody explains to say that we are technologically fully connected and we know what's happening out there, of course you will know it from a knowledge perspective, but from an action point of view, you need to be locally present there. I think that guides this business. So our preparedness is wait and capitalize for growth as it returns. Focus on recovery, keep the focus on recovery continuing for next two quarters if necessary or maybe more. Be close to every dealer out there to know what's happening at the local level in terms of discounts and demand. And ensure that you continue to penetrate deeper, adding more branches. But finally, use your existing customer as your large fleet of people out there on the market. I mean, you just look at that, if 3 million, 3.5 million, 4 million customer of ours, if all of them can just give me one inquiry per year, I will still have 4 million inquiry to manage, which is larger than the total vehicle sales of this country. Is that the preparedness? That's where we are investing our money on. How to be in contact and in touch with the customer for him to be able to refer customers to us. And if that can happen, I think that's where the volume of business for us is. If you look at our uncovered portion of 40% on what, 2,100 crores gross NPA? Yeah. So you take 40% uncovered is only 800 crores, which was what our last year's provision was. and we have a collateral underlying for a value higher than that. So I don't think we have now a problem in from the NPA perspective. Now the problem for us is how do you don't allow new cases to become NPA. So if we can just manage one recovery from every customer diligently, I think we have got a game in hand to play. After 4 quarters, I think the growth has returned to us. That's exciting for all of us. It's exciting for all our people across the country. And I think these sentiments will take us through for this year. We will not overdo anything. We will not be under pressure of any manufacturer for us to overdo anything. We understand what we need to do more prudently, but we will ensure that what we do is well understood by us and consciously done by us and not forced to be done by somebody to us. That's the approach we are going to take, and we believe that we have a role to play and we differentiate in this market when compared to anybody else. We believe commercial vehicle business will return. I was hearing some murmur wherever you travel saying, oh, commercial vehicle is pickup is happening. I'm sure that must be one of your questions possibly. But I want to already answer you saying that it's not happening. I think because they thought that infrastructure will happen, coal movement will start, mining will commence, all of this is going to happen, and the discounts in commercial vehicle may vanish in next 1 quarter. Lot of them have bought vehicle thinking, let's take it when the discounts are available. But the load is still not there for vehicle to be enough viable. But for sure, all of this when it unfolds, it will be the commercial vehicle which will show the first sign of improvement before any other vehicle can show. The contracting segment when it gets announced, coal movement when it starts, mining when it commences, road projects, take it by whatever means, or exports or industrial output, take it whichever way one wants to. When all of this happens, it's the commercial vehicle segment which will first start reacting, and that will be the return of growth. And we are ready and we want to embark on that story. Last round, we made a silly mistake of entering the commercial vehicle segment at the fag end, because nobody could predict that India's story is going to go down that fast. And we got caught. Good news was we were small, so we could withdraw. The good news is we have not dismantled that team. We are still having all those experts still continuing with us. And we believe that we can take that business back to that growth story as it recommences. So I think that is what is going to really ensure that each of our segment, the growth will happen. In each of our segment or each of the geography, the growth will come. And from each of the geography, we'll make sure that the money that's out there is waiting to be collected. The good news is we meet customer, we meet assets. We don't lose either of them. Yes, if one of them is missing, act fast. If both are missing, just silently walk away from there. If both are there, don't too much worry about it. I think in our case, we see a larger percentage of both of them being there. And that what gives us confidence that we can continue to keep growing in this direction. It'll take some time for us to get back to where we belong to. But the growth is returned. It will have this bumpy ride even this year. What used to be first half and second half seems to have become alternate quarters because of the stretched cash flow and the delayed cash flow. Right? But we know for sure that rural story will have to happen if India's story has to unfold. It's a question of how much patience you have, how long are you willing to wait in that geography, and how can you convince your team to continue in the same direction with which we have built this business. So I was just telling Dinesh, from 95 we started active operations of this business, and this year will be the 20th balance sheet that we will sign in terms of actual operation. So some quick numbers that we were looking for, we had one branch then and we have 1100 branches today. We were 5 crore or something like that as balance sheet, we have 40,000 crore balance sheet close to. Our net worth was 5 crore, we are 6,000 crores or whatever. So I think it's done well for us, so we've got into now the next phase of that growth. So when 10 years later we put these numbers, will it look the same way the first 10 years looked like? The hope is that, passion is that, drive is that, people are the same, penetration is our strategy. I think we believe that that's what will take us to that new market. I open you for all questions, whatever that you may have. I want to leave you with this thought that we believe that growth will return, but not in a hurry, nor are we in a hurry to chase that. But we will be there, we will have patience, we will not miss the opportunity, but when it returns, it will give us a longer play to play. Thank you so much.
only two possibilities, right? Either I was very clear or I was totally confusing.
So this is Sunil Tirumalai from Credit Suisse. Had a couple of questions on the interesting trends in the value of asset finance that you report. It's gone up 7%, or that's what my numbers say, and the number of contracts is flat YOY. Has the ticket size gone up? The discounts definitely have not come down. So I just wanted to get your sense. I have a follow-up on that.
Ticket size has not gone up at 72% or something is our LTV, which continues to be that. I think the good news is many of the personal segment, like even Mahindra, SUVs and Scorpios, have started going into that market big time. So when you get those volumes, they are very high value items, right? So therefore, even the numbers, though they are flat, you got the benefit of high value products. And that is how the increases.
Plus, SME is also
one. Yeah, plus SME segment has come in. So it's a product mix change and it's not LTV change. In short, what we're trying to tell you is it's a product mix change and not an LTV change.
Okay, and just related to that, given that M&M sales are not really very strong, so which are the brands and what, you know, what are the market shares that you're gaining to, for you to get these numbers?
See, interesting thing for us is we are not 100% market share in any product. So it really doesn't bother if somebody sells less or somebody sells little more. What we have to make sure that what volumes for which we have created infrastructure we should not lose. And that pushes up the market share or sometimes brings down the market share. So let's take a branch here, and if I decide I have to do 50 vehicle from here, I shouldn't much bother, oh, M&M sales have come down by 5, what will happen? I have to do 50 vehicle. So in that particular situation, maybe your market share looks to be 2% more. So it's only a denominator effect. It's not, you know, we have an ability. I mean, what's our capability to suddenly increase market share or suddenly bring down market share? We don't have switch on off methods. Who will want to use you if that's what you're going to do? But what we go and put pressure on the dealer and agree upon with him is you have to promise me a minimum volume for which I set up a branch. Yes, if the dealer is selling less than that, of course, then it's a problem there. And that's the reason we even got into multi-product. So please don't look at it at all from the point of view of, oh, have you gained substantial market share, so have you done something very different? Nothing. If they sell less and we still do the same number, market share goes up. If you do the same number and they sell little more, the market share looks to have come down.
Yes, and sorry, the last question is on the NPA recognition. What's the timeline you have in mind in terms of the migration? From 150 to 90, you're not in a hurry for this year, but do you envisage an accelerated movement?
See, we are at 150 already, right? We are already at 150. So that way we have a benefit of 1 year in hand, maybe few days here and there that we may need to do. If you are exactly at 150, do we want to be a little less than 150 so that we are not caught on the borderline kind of a situation? There are some discussions that we are internally doing to say all new businesses should we start providing differently. So there'll be different combinations that we will look at. Maybe we will start looking at different product lines where we may want to accelerate a little more than we are today. But very interesting thing about this business is when the business picks up, even collection becomes extremely good. Right? Because these are all earn and pay segment. So if the business is good, means collection will be good. But we will come back to all of you whenever we take the decisions very quickly. But at least currently we are not, you know, very different from what was expected of us. We are already at 150 days. Right, so there is no pressure on us, but if we can be better than where we are, then we communicate very differently.
Good evening. Sharad here from Mikra. I just wanted to understand from you the segment-wise asset quality in your portfolio. And as a follow-up to that, what would be a risk perception internally among the across the various segments of your business?
Segment-wise. You wanted segment-wise asset quality?
Yes, sir.
Oof. I don't know whether we have it ready with you. Okay. So I can tell you our balance sheet breakup. I don't know. We don't normally share the segment-wise asset quality, because then you will start plotting numbers for the manufacturer. And and I don't want to be answerable for it. But our balance sheet is about 18% tractors, 30-32% UVs and things like that, 30-odd% cars, 7-8% commercial vehicle, construction equipment, small LCV, etc. And about, I think, 10% or so will be, 10-12% will be the pre-owned vehicle. What we have seen is the behavior of asset across geography is the same. So there is no exception to geography at this stage in terms of improvement or deterioration beyond. And the third is, you must know one thing for us is, we are 80% plus or maybe 90% of our customers are earn and pay segment. So it does not matter which product he is using. If he's not earning locally, he's not able to pay. So it's more based on the local economy rather than the product that he owns, because we are not on a fixed cash flow customer.
Yeah, sir. Kunal Shah from Edelweiss. So, in terms of the increase in yields which have been there quarter on quarter, okay, from Q3 to Q4, if you can just give a broad breakup as to how much would be, say, on account of penal interest collection, how much would be, say, on account of interest income reversals because of the improvement in the NPL trend, and how much would be, say, on account of, say, any kind of a tweaking in the lending rates in any of the product segment?
So, let me start with the third one, that's easiest. There is no big increase in lending rate. So therefore, it would have been caused by the other two, of which the penal interest will be more or less same as the previous year, maybe some 5-10% more than previous year. It will not be substantially higher. So it will normally be the benefit of or pressure out of income reversal. Dinesh, you want to?
Yeah. So from previous quarter, if you see, there is a 50 basis point increase, and of that 50 basis point, roughly around 15 basis point one can contribute towards the penal interest, and around 35 basis point on account of the income reversal, right back on account of the NPA reduction.
Okay, and sir, if you can just comment on any kind of impact which this unseasonal rains can have on our business in any of the product segment.
So we are calling it a special rains, not unseasonal. Like special trains for holidays, it's a special rain which has come in holidays. But I don't know, and how much of this you will buy, my argument also, I don't know. These kind of impacts are one very media-based impact. On the ground, will it be same as much as you and I read and understand? The answer could be no. Does it mean there is absolutely no impact? The answer is no for that either. So it has huge sentimental impact and little less cash flow impact. Because, you know, we look at it from our point of view of how you're going to recover and whatever. You look at it from their point of view, how they are going to survive. Right? So they find alternate ways of living, and they survive this. So the sentiment impact is very high when this happens, but the adjustments are also equally fast. And therefore, we don't necessarily see that all this impact that we read and understand translate into everything going wrong and negative. And in some pockets, it will be terrible, which is, let's say that if they depend only on this. I mean, let me give you one classic example of Maharashtra. I'm sure you must have also read. Sugarcane crop is at its best possibly, but the price is low and the cash flows are not there. No. It's as bad as an untimely rain is, because both has the same cash flow effect. But will therefore nothing happen in these places? Of course, there'll be a lot of activities which will happen. Things will temporarily get delayed. Aspirational purchases will go down, and they come back. I think if you go back in history for last 20 years, 30 years, these kind of things would have happened every year somewhere or the other. It gets projected higher for us to either get worried or get ready to plan with. We have to decide what do we want to do. When we read this, do we want to plan or you want to get worried? And our belief is that you better plan, better understand the sentiments. Partner, some markets will react negative. You will have to go slow. Don't lend in this market for next 3 months. Will be one decision clearly. But I don't think we want to estimate that this is going to be too severe for us to, you know, what next kind of a fear, no. But the impact is there, sentiments are weak. But in the next 3 to 6 months, let's imagine that a lot of infrastructure story gets announced in UP. Believe in me, they will forget that the wheat crop was bad. But if nothing gets done, and only some free concessions are given to say, oh, you are suffering, so take this money, I think they will continue to want to suffer. Our understanding is with elections coming around the corner in that state, etc., you will see some quick announcements happening on the infra front where the labor will get better deployed locally and their attentions will move away from the sentiment weakness that they are going through. And for all that you know, you may be shocked at the end of 3 months that UP actually is registering growth in spite of this. So you go back, 3 years back or so when monsoon was declared below average and tractor registered growth, purely on infra projects that got announced across the country. So I think the governments will react very quickly and very differently rather than the old traditional manner.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Hi, this is Pradeep from Philip Capital. So if you can give some color as to your collection efficiency ratio during the quarter and how that stacks in terms of your monthly collection efficiency, if you can break it into January, February and March, and whether you know that unseasonal rains or your special rains in March have impacted your collection efficiency in March vis-a-vis your same month last year.
Let me start with March. I was just looking at number. We are 109% collection efficiency in March, which is equal to last March.
Okay.
And overall year, I think, was something like 94% or something, which was also exactly like last year or almost like last year, mm-hmm. but on a higher current demand. So which means absolute money collected is more than previous year, while the percentage is still the same.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. See, I just want to once again mention to you that our customers may not have an ability to pay 3-4 installments at a time when they become high overdue. But they do have an ability to pay either one installment or part installment every month if you chase very regularly. Because we should not forget that almost all these products are livelihood products. If they can't pay me a part of the installment, their chances of survival itself is questioned. It's a question of how many times are you able to reach him in difficult times and therefore collect your money, versus how many times you wait for him to come and pay, therefore you collect nothing.
Right. Okay. So you mentioned 109% collection efficiency was in March month only?
Only 1 month.
And what will be the for the quarter?
Quarter, maybe some 94-96%, because overall average has been 93 for the year.
No, because you know, in your earlier conversations, if I'm not wrong, we were expecting about 105% collection efficiency for the March quarter.
Yeah, so what's the question?
I mean, for this March quarter, normally, yeah. You know, what is the collection efficiency ratio and what is the actual ratio this quarter?
Okay, do we have only March? But we can give it to you, but it will not be very different from last quarter, because if we were 109 in March and last March also 109, my guess is we will not be very different. Maybe 1% here or there, maybe there, but otherwise, I don't know what is this 105 that you're saying, but 109 is our March number. And I know for sure Jan-Feb would be in the vicinity of 95-96 kind of a situation. So which would have ended up at 101-102 overall for the quarter.
Correct me if I'm wrong. In last two quarters, normally you have a collection efficiency ratio of about 98%, which was about 93% in actual terms. Am I right?
Our third quarter was miserable.
So 93%, even below than that?
Even in that quarter, you're asking, was it 93?
Yeah.
It would not have been, because you see our NPA numbers had jumped in that quarter.
Okay.
It would not have been 93. It would have been some 90s and 91s or something like that.
Okay.
Okay. Is we can share that.
Yeah, but we can share with you.
Okay.
But you can send a
communication. I don't know. I mean,
How will it, I mean, what exactly do you want to know by
See,
this?
I want to know whether normally what has been the trend, we have slipped in earlier two quarters, right?
Three quarters, not two.
Yeah, two to three quarters. So yeah. Whether we have covered that or still there is, you know, some kind of delay which is happening or postponement which is happening on those which were due in last three quarters.
Just go by one comment that I made. Our customer do not have ability to pay five installments at a time. So we would not have covered for whatever we have slipped. We would have substantially covered, but not fully covered.
Okay.
That's for sure. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Secondly, you know, as you mentioned...
Secondly, no, this is fourthly.
No, I'm coming to my next question.
I'm just kidding. Don't worry.
Yeah. So, you know, as you mentioned, your strategy will continue to penetrate deeper into rural geography. And if I look at your distance between branches, you have already, you know, come down from 100 kilometers to now about 50, 55 kilometers, right? Hmm. How far can we go deeper into rural geography? Okay. And
we have 6 lakhs villages in the country. Our understanding is 2 lakh villages are not commercially viable to do big business. Mm-hmm. So we have 4 lakh villages. We are there somewhere around 2 lakh plus village. So we have to cover another 2 lakh village. So which will mean if you want another 1,000 branch, there is a scope to add over a period of time.
Okay. Okay. And some guidance on your GNP number where you...
I hope people don't mistake that it's between you and me alone.
No, because, you know, in last con call you mentioned that you are expecting GNP ratio to peak at about, 8 and then move backward. So whether you continue
to maintain...
अरे यार
अच्छा नहीं करेगा तो आप लोग पूछता अच्छा किया तो आठ तक क्यों नहीं गया पूछता तुम ऐसा क्या करता है यार तुम
ऐसा भी मत करो ओके
डोंट फोर्स अस टू टेक इट टू 8 जस्ट बिकॉज़ वी सेड सम टाइम इट विल बी 8 या
नो आई एम नॉट फोर्सिंग आई एम जस्ट सेइंग whether you know we still remain you know keep our fingers crossed in terms of that number will, you know, we will see in next two quarters or whether things have changed.
Let me, for the benefit of everybody, say, while these are all percentages and it will have some denominator effect, if the asset grows, 5 will start looking like 3 and all that. So don't go by all of that. But simply look at, we look at one number of customer who are delinquent. Okay. As of 31st March, I think we have something like 66,000 customer or whatever. And they were almost the same number in April, 1 year back.
Mm-hmm.
Right, and I had explained this in the third quarter that while the NPAs have jumped, number of customers have not jumped, except that the provision within the buckets have gone up, which is why coverage ratios were not going up. Now, if you see the coverage ratio has also gone up, that whosoever has not been able to collect moving upward, the provision has become higher and the number of customers have been controlled.
Right.
Come on, let's move to the next one. Ask some business questions.
Hello, sir. This is Gautam Jain from GC Investments. Good numbers. First, right now we are into vehicle financing and rural housing financing. Do we have any plans to go into other asset financing or like consumer durable, SME kind of? First. Second question, whenever there's rural India growth story come, whether it's a growth slowing down or growth going up, MMFS come first. There is media, business expert, new channels everywhere. Do we have any plans to go into urban market with any of the products? Thank you.
One is, of course, other products. When you say SME is something which is surely area of big interest to us because of the Mahindra ecosystem itself. You know, large Mahindra suppliers who supply to Mahindra or even to other OEMs, and therefore that's one area of interest. So we have internally decided when it comes to SME, we look at engineering, agri, and auto as the three industry verticals where we will participate. As you know, currently these industries are also going through tough times, and therefore you may not see an aggressive positioning from us, but this is something we will master and try to grow in this industry. So from an SME perspective, clearly that's an area of interest. As far as other asset classes are concerned, at least in the family of automobiles, etc., what is left is only two-wheeler. I don't think we have any big plans to be participant in two-wheeler as a segment because it's a very different cost segment. It requires a different approach, high volume game. The other asset class which is possible is the gold loan. Even there we think this infrastructure, this set of people with these processes, I think it's a fantastic prescription for failure.
if we try and go with these branches and start doing gold loan, etc., I think we will have to write it off under CSR only over a period of time. So you'll have to set up altogether a new setup, different skill sets, and I don't think at this stage we are in a hurry. And I want to restate that I don't think we have huge pressure on the asset side from growth perspective. Today the volumes are subdued, we are also not growing. And we will not do anything silly just to offset that loss of growth by adding new product lines that we don't understand. We will not do that. We will wait for an opportune time. Automobile sales will return, tractor sales will pick up, pre-owned vehicle market will open up, and we'll get our growth momentum back.
Any plans for inorganic growth?
Tell us some name, we will closely look at it.
Thank you.
So, Manish from Deutsche Bank. If you look at the various finance, cars, UVs, tractors, at the industry level, which of these do you think can deliver double-digit growth in fiscal 16? Especially if you believe that some of the CV demand has been front-loaded, tractors because of the slowdown or special rains, demand can get impacted. Which industry segment you think can deliver double-digit growth for fiscal 16 for now?
I think new product launch will drive the double-digit growth, which means car segment is what my guess is.
Because anything which is
going to be infra dependent for growth, anything which is going to depend on large manufacturing segment pickup for growth, I think we'll have wait for some more time. It's the personal segment where cash flows are not as badly impacted. Therefore, you continue to see that growth momentum coming from car new product launches. So I'm hearing many of the manufacturers, earlier they used to do car product launch only for urban centers. We are now hearing them say that we will open it up across. So I guess that car will drive growth. And I also think pre-owned vehicle will grow faster than new vehicle growth in this 1 year.
My second question is, some of us in our community believe that the semi-urban rural is slowing down much more than urban. Do you subscribe to that opinion, and do you believe that the divergence will play out in vehicle finance or vehicle demand going forward?
I mean, definitely, I don't know whether how to compare it with urban for it to call it as slow or otherwise, but the volumes in rural market has come down. I mean, if tractor is degrowing, it's all rural product, it's not an urban product. So I think it's no guess from anybody. Yes, rural is slowing down, but look at what drives rural growth. It has to be big time infra growth, which is where the labor deployment therefore will happen, and therefore the cash flows of that market being better. It has to be farm segment definitely registering growth, and therefore rural growth will happen. And all of this are subdued, and therefore definitely rural is stable, degrowing, sentiments are low. Now, how does one compare this to urban? I don't know, because on a sheer size basis, urban was always higher than rural. We put some growth rate around it because earlier rural was 10, became 20, we said 100% growth. That percentage wise, if you look at, I don't have that access to say whether urban is growing faster, rural is growing slow, whatever. But the drivers of rural is definitely not at its best, and therefore rural growth is slowing down. Now, comparison I may not want to make, but definitely it is. Like, if you look at absolute volumes of any of the product in rural in the last 3 years, it will suggest that it is selling less and being bought less.
Thank you, sir.
Hi, I have two questions. This is Irene from Goldman. One for you, Ramesh, and another for the insurance company.
Can you reverse the question? First the insurance.
Okay, that's more of a slightly macro-related question. With a lot of farmer suicides, which we have been seeing in the press and around, one of the areas which people say is the lack of crop insurance. And I just wanted to hear your thoughts about what could be done to improve the overall crop insurance penetration, and as a company, whether you can do anything or whether you are doing anything about it. And yeah, second question I'll put later.
This is actually the current challenge for this country, because if I just share some statistic which is available in the public domain, in the last 17 years, there have been more than 3 lakh suicides. So it's a very startling number. And for a country where you're agrarian dependent, and if these are the kind of startling numbers, obviously there is a huge responsibility, I would say, not even the duty, and it's a duty for all of us to find some solution for crop insurance especially. Now, there have been a couple of challenges. One, the kind of details which are required to actually administer a crop insurance. We need to build that infrastructure to do that. It is not about the distribution of a crop insurance, which probably is slightly easier because we can find different mechanisms through NGOs or through various other gram panchayats to distribute it. But the bigger challenge is, how do you actually settle a claim? And currently, the way it is being handled, or whatever has been suggested, given our current limitations on the meteorological department data which is available or not available, is that claim settlement gets done in zones. And so it's not like if you have a farm, you need to settle claim for that farm. So we don't have that micro-level data available to settle a claim for that. Okay, so with the use of technology, so there is a lot of optimistic outlook which we have, is that because of the use of technology, now you see Google Maps being used extensively, there will be different tools which will come up. And a lot of companies are working towards finding solutions to this, because that is the biggest challenge to overcome. If we can find solutions to crop insurance to be distributed and claims being settled correctly for those people, I think we would have had a biggest opportunity in this country to really grow very fast. So there is a lot of work happening from the insurance company side, because currently the Agriculture Insurance Corporation of India, AICFI, is the one which is actually administering these various schemes. And they're getting subsidized by the government. But unless we find a viable proposition, which should be commercially viable for insurance companies also to participate and do it, so regulators looking at it, and insurance companies are trying to find out solutions. We as an insurance broking company are also looking at it very intensely, because we feel it's an opportunity for us to go and distribute more products to the rural segment. So as and when we get some solutions, obviously we'll share it with you. Thank you.
Sure. Thank you. The other question on the core asset financing business, you said there are 4 or 5 signs whether the growth is coming back or not, in terms of whether discounts are going away or whether the second-hand vehicle demand is improving and all. Are you seeing any of those signs playing out in any of your markets, or it's currently not happening?
I thought when I listed out, it was only because we are not seeing those signs. So, not yet. Not yet. The answer is not yet.
This is Mayur from Wealth Managers. I had a question on rural housing.
Thank you.
We have been present across 9 states for quite a while. And last year, if I remember correctly, we were at around 35,000-36,000 villages coverage. Now we are around 40,000 villages. Our parent is present in 2 lakh villages. And if you look at the number of states covered, if you look at, yes, the AUM has been growing, I understand, and we have doubled, every 2 years we are doubling. But in terms of coverage, in terms of spreading out, do we believe that we have lagged our own targets, or could it have been more, or what is stopping us from that?
No, I think deliberately we were following a strategy of more intensive coverage this year, because that has a beneficial impact on your operating costs. I'll just try and explain. I mean, if you go to one village and try and collect an EMI from only one customer, our typical EMIs are, let's say, about 2,500 rupees. So you can imagine the cost involved in that, because the person has to travel maybe 50 kilometers to collect that EMI and maybe go thrice to collect that EMI. Instead of that, if the same village, or let's say 2-3 villages on the same route, you have maybe 15 customers, your cost is brought under control. So that was the entire intention behind going more intensive coverage this year. And like I mentioned in my brief speech, we are going to be doing both. More intensive, continue the strategy of more intensive coverage, and then start looking at more states this year, as well as more villages in the same state. So that's the increase in the width is going to happen this year.
Okay, thank you. One for insurance.
Sure.
What would be the premium collection you said?
Premium was 1,000 crores, 1,002.
So what would be the ratio sustainable for premium to income over a period of as we move ahead? Will it be remaining at 15% kind of levels which we see or?
Actually, it's a factor of multiple product. It's the product portfolio mix. So today we are concentrated largely on the motor insurance portfolio. So as and when that mix changes for some reason, like for instance, third party premium has been increased from 1st of April. So that will give us some little boost on the premium part, but there is no direct income attached to that. So the ratios will change based on how the market actually changes its configuration.
Yeah, but broadly as we see next 3-4 years, do we see that this ratio anyway?
Yeah, we are trying to maintain that ratio. We're trying to maintain that.
You added a color on the reinsurance. In
yes.
terms of numbers, what it must have added to our...
It's not a significant, I think it's still in the business, in the infancy stage, I would say. Here the business, what Ramesh was also alluding to, is building a relationship because reinsurance business happens largely on trust. So today we are able to build relationships across 30 countries. Okay, so it's a small business, but relationship is important. In fact, it will happen for the next 1.5 to 2 years also, we'll focus on building that relationship. Once we are at a particular level of relationship, only then the business transactions start happening. So right now it is not a very significant portion in terms of its business contribution, but it is definitely in terms of its presence and you know, relationship building.
Thank you.
So can we have the remaining questions during the dinner? Or maybe two more questions? I think, yeah.
Hi, thanks for the opportunity. Just one question on rural housing finance. If you can explain in terms of business sourcing, like for auto loans and all, we have dealerships and all, but as far as rural housing is concerned, how do we go about sourcing these 1 lakh rupee loans?
Our entire sourcing is through our own employees. So we really have to go to a village, hold what we call a Gram Sabha, which is, you know, gather about 20 odd people and start talking to them. We do leverage the Mahindra Finance, not just the infrastructure, but also the customer base. So the entry to a particular village is more often than not provided to us by a Mahindra Finance customer who introduces us to the local leadership, villagers, etc., and then we set the ball rolling. It's all entirely in-house. We don't have any channel partner.
Thank you.
And the last question now.
No, he's coming.
Hey. Yeah. Others have to hear you.
Hi. Listening to this way you source your housing finance loans, basically, does microfinance come as a natural extension to your business on a larger scale? If I take a longer perspective, say 5-10 year perspective.
The microfinance customer would be a shade below the kind of customer we are talking about. Our customer is, let's say, 1,50,000 average income, whereas the microfinance customer is typically no income, where he's given or she is rather given an 50,000, not even 50,000, a 10,000 rupee loan. And trained to do something to generate income. So really you're talking about a customer who's got practically no income and then you develop the person and go forward.
Secured, unsecured.
Yeah, and of course we are...
is an unsecured.
Yeah.
Whereas this is a secured. That's the...
And one small question was like observing other microfinance companies who operate predominantly in rural areas, those people have seen really low gross NPAs and stuff like that. So I just wanted to pick your brain if you have any perspective on that. Why does that segment see such a low non-performing asset base and why do the bigger rural people see a higher?
One key difference between microfinance and any asset-based lending is the microfinance borrower
is always told that he's going to get slightly more loan every year if he pays. And the second thing, of course, is the peer pressure, because it's a joint liability. Typically, it's a joint liability. Since the EMI is very small, there are a lot of times when people sort of share the money and pay up for a defaulter, because they all know that if the payment is not made next year, they will not, or after 50 weeks, they will not be entitled to go from 50,000, from 10,000 to maybe 15,000 or 20,000. And that increase in their loan is crucial for them, because that's the only way they can increase their income, since it's an income generating kind of asset. So that's I think a crucial difference between what they do and what we do.
Thank you.
Thank you all. Now I request you all to join us for the dinner. And during that, you can continue with your questions.